Hi there, soundtrack geniuses. Marius Masalar here again to welcome back a special guest, Jason Graves. It's been a busy couple of years for you, Jason. How have you been doing?
I've been busy but happy.
That's a good way to be.
Most definitely.
So when we last spoke, you were actually just wrapping up some studio construction, I think. How did that all turn out?
Oh, man. You know, the perfect answer to that question is go listen to Tomb Raider, because the studio is the whole entire reason I was able to do everything I did with the Tomb Raider score. It's more than I ever would have hoped for, the studio and the construction. Just having a properly built room with good mics and built-in wiring in the walls and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I went from the 8 microphone jacks that they gave me, and I was saying, I'm not going to need 8. And they patted me on the shoulder and said, let's just put in these 8. Well, now I've got 48.
Oh, my God.
So that shows you how much I'm using it and, how much fun it is.
Nice. So let's talk a bit about Tomb Raider. What was your relationship to the series before you got this project? Were you a fan of the previous games? Were you not terribly familiar with them? Where did you stand?
Well, the first one, it was either the first or the second. I don't remember. One of those was kind of the first 3D platformer that I saw. And, you know, we know when I say 3D in mid-90s, it doesn't mean actual 3D, but it wasn't like a side-scroller. You know, you could go explore. And it really blew me away at the time. And I kind of lost touch after Tomb Raider 3, I think. But the general idea, I mean, I think Lara is the most recognizable video game character outside of Mario. So I knew what it was, and I knew what it meant to have the chance to do something like Tomb Raider. So I think it was the best of both worlds, because I was aware of the responsibility, but I didn't have fresh music and video and everything playing in my head when I heard the words Tomb Raider. I was thinking more back to the original series, and I was able to kind of start with a clean slate, a lot more than if I'd been playing through, you know, Angel of Darkness and all the newer ones.
Yeah. So, I mean, because you had that clean slate, what sorts of goals did you have in mind in terms of portraying the new vision of Lara Croft? What picture did you want to paint for us as the listeners?
You know, it's funny because I always, as a composer, I always feel like I don't quite get to do X on a certain game. You know, maybe it's something like Dead Space and it's not quite scratching my melody itch. You know, I wish that I could do more themes, or maybe it's some sort of very thematic game and I wish that I could put more textures and things into it, but it wouldn't be appropriate for the game. And that's totally cool. But what was crazy about Tomb Raider is, even with the initial discussion with the team before I was even officially hired, they were kind of ticking all the boxes of things that I would want to do with kind of my dream project. You know, they said they wanted themes. They wanted to have a new main theme, and they wanted other character themes that would actually mean something and play in significant times, as opposed to just some general theme that plays all the time. They wanted to have percussion. They didn't know I was a percussionist at the time, but I am a drummer and percussionist first. So being in this new studio, I thought it would be really cool to be able to play some percussion on something. And then they wanted some sort of intangible something that would make the score differentiate itself from other titles. And that's something, ever since the first Dead Space, I've been keen on trying something like that textural kind of thing, but without an orchestra, maybe with a couple of players, or maybe even just with me, which is what it turned out to being, is me experimenting with all these instruments and textures and things, and putting all those three things together into kind of the ultimate score for me personally was just a dream come true. It was everything that I wanted to do, and they never told me no. They agreed to anything I suggested, and it really was, if no one likes it, it's I'm the only one that can be to blame, because it was all, they left all the responsibility on my shoulders.
Well, I don't think there's any risk of that, but I'm very happy to hear that. So it sounds like they gave you a clean slate and all of the opportunity, and you just got to run with it.
They really did. I mean, and we'll talk about some of the crazy stuff they let me do. And it was just every single time I suggested something, it was only because they allowed the previous things to go through. So it kind of pushed me to, you know, try keep, even crazier yeah. stuff.
Keep pushing the boundaries.
Exactly.
Well, just before we talk about the major boundary that you pushed, you said earlier that you think Lara Croft is one of the most iconic video game characters. I'm wondering if you could explain a little why you think that she's, I guess, so compelling a character to the gaming population in general, because she seems, to me at least, to be appealing to a very broad audience in a way that a lot of other action heroes from games have maybe not managed to be.
And that's an interesting question, because I think she started out that way. And I love that you pronounce her name correctly. I can't do it. I've been saying Laura forever. So Lara, you know, I can't. Lara, yeah. I think it started that way, especially the first two or three titles. Just the fact that she was a woman and it wasn't this huge bodybuilder, you know,
yeah,
Rambo or Arnold Schwarzenegger or something like that. So there was a built-in kind of vulnerability and accessibility to her. But as the games progressed, it became kind of the cliche.
It's true, yeah.
You know, prototype of a girl with, you know, a figure like that and two pistols and there you go. So what I loved was the fact that they were going to reboot her and really strip her down and start out with what, to me, made her so incredibly accessible in the beginning back in 96, that, you know, she's not a big guy. She's a girl and now she's young. She's just out of school. She has no confidence whatsoever. She has no skill whatsoever. And the whole goal, especially with the music, was to make you feel compassion for her. And I don't know how many video game characters, you know, that would be the developer's goal from the beginning, is, okay, we want you to feel compassion. We want you to, you know, actually feel some sort of emotion for this character that you're playing, as opposed to, we want you to feel like a badass. We want you to feel like you're invincible. We want you to feel like you can do anything, which is kind of what the best video games do. You know, any of the shooters and things like that. You're like, oh, I'm so cool. Look at what I'm doing. This is awesome.
Yeah.
And they were doing the opposite, you know, at least for the first part of the game. And to me, that was kind of the hook. That's what's going to get a lot of people involved and emotionally involved in the game.
Yeah, she does seem a lot more real to me as a character than the sort of parody that she had become of herself in some of the past games.
Yeah.
But it's cool that you say the developers had that in mind from the beginning, because one of the things that I noticed about the game itself and specifically about the violence is that I cared more about it. There was something a little more personal when Lara got hurt, as opposed to, I mean, you're used to scoring violence. Obviously, you've just come off of the Dead Space series, but somehow, you know, when Isaac gets hurt, I don't feel as connected to him, because I suppose he doesn't really feel very vulnerable to me. So it's interesting that that was something intentional in the game design and in your process as well.
I was really amazed, because the first meeting I had at Crystal, they had the whole dog and pony show that they had done overseas for Square Enix, which involved, I mean, a couple of hundred PowerPoint slides and probably an hour and 20 minutes worth of talking and explaining everything from the characters in the game to kind of the arc that Lara would have from the beginning to the end. And it was all about progression and the fact that she had to start. It's almost like going to boot camp. Like, you know, they break you down so they can build you back up. And that's what they were trying to do with Lara. They knew that they had to start from scratch and just really break her down,
yeah,
so that they could build her back up. And even with everything that they said, I was concerned that they would still start out the music big. They'd say, okay, we need to have an epic thing that plays over the menu, and then when this plays at the beginning, it's going to be this huge, you know, epic, and also wall-to-wall music, which is what a lot of the previous Tomb Raider games were.
Yeah,
they just had pervasive music, and this was a shared frustration inside the audio team.
Yeah,
and from the beginning, I thought, I'm going to do everything I can to avoid that, and I'm going to do everything I can to avoid the, you know, oh yeah, Tomb Raider.
The macho thing. Yeah,
we needed to be quiet and sensitive and intimate and kind of the antithesis of any adjective you wouldn't use to normally describe video game music.
Yeah, Well, I mean, one of the things that you did to get the score there was building an instrument, and I know this is kind of the exciting thing that people have been talking about. But tell us a little bit about how you got from, oh, let's try a new sound, to, okay, let's build this strange machine, this awesome contraption, and then use that as the basis of a lot of the opening cues.
Well, it all started with the studio.
Yeah, okay.
So having a proper recording studio with good mics and being able to play my own percussion, I was to be able to do this the first time in my life at proper quality, you know, the same gear that anybody else in the industry in a recording studio would use. I was really blown away at how natural and just effortless it was. I put a decent sounding drum in front of a good mic, I record it, and wow, it sounds like a really good sounding recording of a drum.
Yeah.
So I went from that and started kind of expanding my circle. Well, what else can I record? There are the bad guys on the island are called scavengers, and their kind of bases and homes are all this, you know, corrugated metal and rebar and kind of nasty looking stuff. So
yeah,
I thought it might be cool to try to find some things like that. I had some leftover construction stuff outside. So I had, you know, metal buckets and some rolled up chicken coop fencing that hadn't been used, and a big aluminum trash can, stuff like that. And I was, you know, found sounds that were in the backyard, and they sounded pretty cool. They sounded different. And then I was out of stuff. I had three things. The developer loved it. It was kind of inspiring to work with, but I had reached my limit. I certainly
didn't. You ran out of things.
Yeah, I mean, and I can't weld, and I'm not really very good with my hands if I'm not playing something. So I had to look elsewhere. And the funny thing is, through Facebook, I knew this guy named Matt, and I knew he was in town, and I saw his Facebook page, and it had these really cool, like, metal-lit sculpture things that he works on. So I just contacted him through Facebook, and it turns out that our studios are about a quarter of a mile from each other.
Oh, wow.
He is literally a 4-minute walk from my house. So I went over just to meet him and tell him what was going on. And it was like I was talking to myself. He was so excited about the idea of trying something new. He was really into experimenting and doing something he hadn't done before. So that kicked off basically a 14-month period of us experimenting with different material and different sounds and trying to figure out how best to basically describe the island. Because the orchestra, the piano, you know, the solo flute, stuff like that, that's Lara. You know, that's personal. That was easy from a textural standpoint.
Yes, yeah.
The island itself, we really wanted, I wanted it to have a unique voice. And basically, what we ended up doing is there's like a metal kind of vessel that acts as a resonating chamber that's got a lot of spikes coming out of it. And I can bow them with a violin bow, or I can tap them with triangle beaters. I can even kind of rub the metal with a rubber mallet, and you get all these different sounds. Those are basically the scavenger sounds. And then there's some glass bowls that I play with mallets of some kind. And
those were the hanging elements, right? Those
yes,
three?
Yes. Yeah. The three kind of different colored yellowish amber glass bowls. Those are literally the voice of the island.
Right.
So if someone talks about trying to get off the island, or if maybe Lara is consciously fighting against the will of the island with storms or lightning or something like that, the glass bowls come into play. And what I loved about those, kind of like any of these pieces, I'm tapping on it in Matt's studio. It's this cavernous warehouse. You can't really hear anything.
Yeah.
And anything that I took, the idea was that it would be modular so that I could take it back to the studio and not worry about fitting it in my door. The final sculpture wouldn't fit in the door, but it's still modular. So I can take the key noise-making things apart and put them on a snare stand or hang them by a mic stand and put a microphone on them.
Oh, see, I didn't get that, because watching the videos, it seems like it's just this one integrated chunk that has to move together as a whole.
Right. And you can tell that the bowls and the chimes in the back, they're hanging, so they can be taken down.
Yeah.
And then the big plexiglass lampshade that's lit up, that's just it just holds that metal bucket thing, and it slides out of the bottom. It was important, obviously, that I be able to record it. So the final version didn't even come together until maybe a couple of days before the camera crew was coming to film that piece on making the actual sculpture. So all the individual pieces had been finished for 6 months and I'd used them in the score, but the final presentation was kind of Matt's ultimate gift, I guess, because I didn't even know what it was going to look like. And we walked in and it was all lit up and presented and it was just, wow, it was so cool and so much bigger than anyone else thought. I knew how big it was going to be, but if you just see a picture of it, it's like, oh, what is that? Like 3 feet tall, 4 feet tall, you know? And it's like, no, you know, the lampshade goes up to just above my waist because the idea is it needs to be at a proper playing height.
Well, yeah, it's an instrument, ultimately.
Yeah, it's monstrous.
What, just out of curiosity, what does Matt typically do? Because for those of us who aren't actually familiar with his work, I mean, was this a huge departure for him to go into sculpting an instrument as opposed to what he was doing before?
Well, I know he's never done anything with the final point being to have it played. He's never done anything that has that kind of an aesthetic that's really rough and gnarly and aggressive looking. But what he does all the time is work with fiberglass, metal, and glass, and usually builds these very kind of feminine, balanced, just beautifully elegant kinds of either sculptures or lights. He does, I think there's something like, you know, 50 or 60 restaurants around here in North Carolina where he's done all the glass work for all their lights, and a lot of hanging sculptures in big offices and a lot of corporate installations. Big, big stuff, though. This was a unique departure for him because he was able to be completely creatively free. And that's the other thing that I think warrants recognition is Crystal never, they said, yes, that sounds great. Build an instrument. We'll even put it in the lobby when the game's finished. So when people come over, they can play it and they can hear the game. Go do your thing and let us know when it's finished. And they never asked to look at it. They never asked what it was going to sound like. They never asked for prototypes. They literally didn't know what they were getting until they showed up with a 10-team camera crew to film it.
Wow. So they were very, very trusting in that regard.
Yes, they were. I honestly can't believe that they didn't bug us. I thought for sure we'd have to go through approvals for how it looks or something like that. And they never... All they have had to say about anything is, that's fantastic. Let's work on, you know, the next step of something.
Well, ultimately, I think what it brought to the score, besides the unique voice, is just, it does sound exotic, but it also, you can kind of tell that it's a very personal kind of instrument, and the collaboration, the fact that you were able to work with another creative person and just freely build this thing over such a long period of time and have it evolve towards your needs is just, it's a wonderful thing.
Having that much time, you know, if we had to do it in 2 months, we would have gotten something, but it wouldn't have been as interesting as that.
Yeah, and in 2 months, you wouldn't have even had the opportunity to really explore the potential of whatever you got as an instrument.
Exactly. It would have turned into some kind of a gimmick that I'm trying to shoehorn in at the last minute. And since we did it this way, especially the bowls, there's three bowls. Each bowl has its own pitch, and those are the only three pitches of bowls that are in the game, and it almost turned into a musical Wilhelm scream to me, where you know, you recognize that scream immediately no matter what movie it's in, and the bowls end up developing that kind of character in the game. You immediately recognize them because it's just those three pitches. You know, I'm not playing it on a keyboard and doing melodies with it or chords. It's just those three pitches over and over and over. I love that.
Yeah, and it is a distinctive timbre. I mean, it's not quite like a gamelan or anything, you know, any typical exotic instrument. So that's, I'm definitely with you there. But beyond the instrument, I mean, this is obviously the showpiece of the score. But you also mentioned a few of the more traditional elements that you had in there and percussion elements. Was there a particular correlation between some of them and thematic elements in the game? I mean, listening to the score, I've come to think of the piano, where you introduce Lara's theme as sort of like her instrument in a sense. But are there other connections like that?
Definitely the piano is Lara. And that wasn't initially, I didn't do it with that intent. I wanted to give them an example of this new theme that they wanted me to write. I wanted to give them the most simple, pure, straightforward version of a theme that I could. And I've always thought some film composer, I can't remember who it is, but they said something like, well, if you older film composer, and they said this rather incredulously, but if you can't play it on the piano, it's not music. And I don't necessarily agree with that statement, but what I do love is that if you're talking about a theme, the piano is the most elegant, simple way to do it. And the piano version that plays over the title, I think there's a cello as well, but that piano theme was literally the exact same theme that I sent them, very first thing I sent before we started working on any in-game music. And they responded to the intimacy and the simplicity and just the familiarity of a piano. Everyone knows what a piano sounds like. So we stuck with it, and it was great. And I love that it's bookended as well, because it plays at the end of the game. Yes, yeah. And there's really only, those are the only two places you hear the piano, the very beginning and the very end. There's some French horn that Roth's theme is played on, especially a solo horn at times of reflection. Maybe Lara isn't even reflecting, but in the game, like after she gets out of some big scrape and she just barely made it and she's thinking about what she needs to do next, I can play Roth's theme kind of to echo what she's thinking about, you know, what he taught her or what she should do. What would he do if he were here? How would he advise me on where to go next?
So that's almost like a theme for their relationship there that the horn handles.
Exactly, exactly. And I really love, there's certain times where his theme is on French horn and her theme is on solo flute, and they're almost playing counterpoint to each other.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of fun working stuff out like that. But aside from that, with the orchestral instruments, you know, the other stuff, I've got stopped horns for Matthias's theme or for the island theme, because they always sound so wonderfully evil and mysterious. But those are probably the most direct instrumental connotations.
Okay. And so for the island, basically, is almost all of the island material just the instrument then? Or did you have other exotic percussion in your collection that you threw in there?
Another thing that was great about Crystal is, even though the island of Yamatai is off the coast of Japan, they never said, the percussion doesn't sound Japanese enough.
Yeah.
You know, I'm always careful to avoid the National Geographic cliches. You know, we're not scoring a documentary. So the only Japanese percussion I used were taiko drums. And the only time I used those were really the last third of the game. And it was more for mass and weight than the fact that we're near Japan, therefore I must use taiko drums.
It's true, yeah. And I mean, the taiko drum has become so ubiquitous in media scoring now, just as that stereotypical big drum sound, because it's such a uniquely powerful percussion instrument.
And the other percussion was intentionally non-geographically specific, which is just basically an awkward way of saying I used a bunch of different instruments. And there were, you know, there were maybe four that I ended up using a lot more than the other ones. A couple of different shakers panned in the left and the right, and then a couple of different drums panned in the left and the right. But it was really just kind of walking around, and I've got stuff everywhere, just picking things up and thinking, well, this sounds kind of cool, and I'd record something. And some things I use, but most of the time, after a couple of months of playing percussion, I didn't have to edit it so much. So I could literally just hit record, do a pass, go back to the beginning, hit record on another instrument, and just do four or five instruments and just kind of perform with my gut.
Yeah.
As opposed to quote unquote writing out a part, because I wanted it to sound more natural, more kind of linear.
Instinctive.
Yeah, yeah. And less four bar loopy.
Yeah, well, it does. I mean, that's part of the reason I ask, actually, is because I'm a huge percussion fan, and listening to the percussion lines in the score, they're very organic and they're very they're dynamic, and they seem to flow in a way that a lot of other percussion elements in games don't. So that's why I was curious about it, and it seems natural to me that you spent so much time trying to get that feel, because it comes across very clearly, I think anyway.
That's so wonderful to hear. That's one of those things that it was kind of in question as to how much percussion to use and what it was supposed to sound like, where it was supposed to sit. You know, this is me, kind of the new guy in the new recording studio with the new microphones. I've been playing percussion forever, but I've never recorded myself, let alone eight tracks of myself. And by the end, what was great about it was actually a lot faster recording live percussion, because I had four different stations set up kind of appropriately mic'd, already EQ'd, and literally panned and everything.
Oh, that's handy.
I would literally, you know, it's like new cue. Okay, well, I got to start with a shaker. Okay, well, where's my favorite shaker? Hold on, what, these guys right here. So, you know, I start with this shaker, and I know that that microphone is already preset to get, you know, panned to 9 o'clock to the left, and it's got the EQ and the little bit of reverb on it. And I play the part, and I go back and I play another one, and six parts later, I don't have to touch a thing. It's already like mixed, quantized, everything.
Yeah, and no MIDI finicking and anything like that.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. It was all about the groove. Yeah.
Well, like I said, it comes across, so it's their mission accomplished on your part. Now, this is kind of, I mean, inevitably people have been comparing Tomb Raider to the Uncharted series because they're both, you know, adventure games. And since it seems that they are familiar in this way, did you actually have any inspiration to draw from Greg Edmondson's work on those scores? Or was it something that just was not really relevant to the development of this score in this game?
I think Greg did an incredible job with the Uncharted series. I would say fortunate for my professional side, unfortunate for my personal side. So busy that I haven't really been able to keep up with soundtracks the last maybe 5 years the way I used to.
Yeah.
I used to just dive into anything I could find, especially starting a new gig, trying to kind of figure out what I wanted it to sound like. And now I've found maybe the last 3 years, it's more about experimenting, especially now the studio's built, experimenting in the studio and trying to find something internally that is different and kind of creatively satisfying than looking to the external, meaning other people's music. But I guess that's what happens after you do this for 50 or 60 hours a week and 10 years going. It just, you end up getting more internalized with what you're trying to find. Does that make sense?
I think so. And at the end of the day, it's also more enriching when you can say, this particular idea came from within and was generated just by the project and by me rather than necessarily having to call upon external influences. So I think that's a very good way of thinking of things. I just ask because, again, like I said, the two games share some similarities in terms of their genres and some of the gameplay aspects.
Yes. And, you know, the funny thing, talking about shared things, I had completely forgotten what the original Tomb Raider theme sounded like.
Yeah.
And apparently a lot of fans heard, I guess it was the first trailer a couple of years ago that I worked on that had the theme playing in the piano. And they responded to, oh, I love how if this is the new Tomb Raider theme, it harkens back to the old one, but it also does its own thing. And I had no idea what the old one sounded like. Well, it turns out that the old one starts on the first note of the scale and then goes up to the second note of the scale and then goes somewhere else. But that's how I started my theme. And I think it's one of those just commonalities. Now that I know my theme so well, because I've heard it over and over and over, I hear those first, you know, I think that's the most common thing in music. You start on the first note of the scale, you go up to the second note of the scale, and I hear it all the time, everywhere. But the fact that the two Tomb Raider themes literally have shared notes, those first two notes are identical, is a happy accident, but I couldn't be more giddy about the fact that that happy accident occurred.
And that the fans picked up on it.
Yes, exactly.
So just on a more technical level about this score, when we were speaking last time, you were talking about how for the Dead Space score, you did a lot of the recording and assembling of the score in a very modular way with specific bits of music that were then assembled either by you or by the engine. Was any of that sort of technique used here for Tomb Raider, or was this a more linear scoring process for you?
This was definitely more linear. The Dead Space games, and including the third one, had a very elegant implementation method with the four layers of music that would fade up or down kind of depending on the gameplay. And back in Dead Space 1 in 2006 or whenever it was I started, that was a very advanced thing, the fact that you could even do that. And the only reason we could do it is it was in EA's proprietary audio engine. Nobody else could do anything like that. Well, middleware apps now that all the developers use to kind of piggyback their music system onto the video system, they can do that and 10,000 times more other things. So we were really free with Tomb Raider to implement the music any way we wanted. And what I loved is we never had one way to do it. Every scenario and every bit of gameplay had its own challenge, and we would, Alex Wilmer was the music director, he and I would literally either sit down together or get on the phone and talk about, well, I would just throw things out. Well, what if when she's doing this, can you have the music maybe? And we would go back and forth, and it went anything from, sure, we'd do layer things, but we'd also do things based on Laura's aggression. You know, how often is she shooting? Well, then if she starts shooting a lot, we can bring in this extra element somehow. Or if there's, you know, the usual more bad guys on the screen, or maybe if she's crouching and hiding, any of those gameplay elements could dictate the score. And what was great was, before I wrote any music for any particular part of the game, we figured out how it was going to be implemented. Then I wrote the music, and then I got a gameplay capture of the music implemented into the game, and we'd have another conversation, which was usually, wow, that worked better than I thought. That's really cool.
So everything was, that's actually very fascinating. Everything being sort of thought out on a scene by scene basis, rather than trying to use one technique for everything.
I'd never done that before, honestly, because no one thought about it. I don't know. I mean, as a composer, all of us composers are always willing to do whatever it takes to make the music sound as good as possible, but it falls on the developer's shoulders to take the time, not only to plan it out, but to implement it. It takes a lot of work to implement this stuff. And what I love is any of these particular scenes you come across in Tomb Raider, little skirmishes or a little, you know, something shows up and you zoom in on it real quick, the music never repeats itself.
Right.
It'll, you know, if there's a skirmish for 20 seconds with these two guys and you take them out or you run away, that music only plays for those two guys, and it was custom scored, and you'll never hear it again in the game. And I'd never been able to do anything like that. It was very empowering.
Well, the end result is also very impressive, because it feels very seamless. Like, all the fact that so much is going on behind the scenes makes it basically invisible to the player, except for the fact that all of the music always seems perfectly appropriate, and you're never having that sense of, you know, oh, I'm so tired of this, you know, action starting cue or whatever it happens to be from other games.
Exactly. And that's, I think, the best compliment that I could get is the music doesn't call a lot of attention to itself unless it's appropriately doing that. It needs to call attention to itself, but in anything else, it should just kind of be in the background moving as you move, and it's just slowly progressing. And you're never really reminded that you're in a game, because everything keeps evolving. It's just slowly changing.
Yeah.
I really like that.
And in terms of that immersion that the music gives you, do you think, I mean, now that we've seen, you know, one of the next gen console announcements, and the next one is coming soon, presumably, do you think that the next generation of consoles will also be able to include more of that kind of technology, not just because of, you know, the actual engines being more complex, but also because the sizes of games will grow large enough to allow more music content?
You know, it's been a couple of years since anyone has said anything like, well, has said the phrase music footprint to me. And I remember even back in Dead Space 1, we had a very specific music footprint, and we knew that we couldn't write more music than X because it literally wouldn't fit on the disc. And I don't know if that has been the case since maybe Dead Space 2, because I think the rule for Dead Space 2 was the interact of everything we did, we could do twice that now, and the music footprint was twice as big. Well, I didn't write twice as much music. I wrote more or less the same amount of music. So
that ceiling you haven't even been bumping up against, essentially.
Yeah, I think that size, the space limitation has gone away. Now what we're dealing with is time. The time on the developer's part to put the music into the game. And what I'm hoping is either the native software for the game itself includes music stuff. The problem there is it's going to be very elementary and you're going to have to start from scratch. What I think might be more realistic is, you know, WYs or any of the other apps that developers use to put the music in the game. They keep becoming more sophisticated. You've got more kind of shortcuts and scripts and things that are pre-built so that you don't have to key in so much stuff. You know, it's like any natural software evolution, but the idea being maybe on the next Tomb Raider, it'll take half the amount of manpower to put the same amount of music into the game properly.
Right. Yeah, that makes more sense, I think. If that's the actual bottleneck, then here's hoping. You know, because I always like more music in games. I mean, that's always, I think, not only for composers, but even for players, there's this sense of you can't really have too much music in the game.
Agreed.
You know, there's never, that doesn't exist. That's not a problem. So,
and it's scalable. That's the irony is it's not just about the music budget and how much music, how many minutes they can quote unquote afford, because the more minutes they hire the composer to compose, the more time they have to pay someone else to implement all of that music and iteration and everything else. So let's hope so.
Yeah. Fingers crossed. So just because you mentioned exploring your own sounds and now you've got your own studio, I've been curious to know if as part of this you were thinking of doing any sort of custom commercial sampling, because I know you do a lot of sampling work for your own scores. You've done it for Dead Space, and obviously you've probably recorded huge amounts of material with the instrument for this Tomb Raider score. Did you ever consider doing anything commercial with some of that material or with new material now that you have this studio?
No, I don't think so. It's I've found, especially now that I have the studio, anything that's sitting around here that I can play, I'm gonna play. I'm not gonna sample it. And it started just with suspended cymbals and gongs. That was my first stuff that I recorded. It's like, well, I love this, you know, 10,000 inch gong that I have a sample of, but that swipe, I only have that one swipe. So I bought a 30 inch gong. Well, the 30 inch gong, me playing it, just swiping, sounded so much cooler and more original than the huge sampled gong. So that's kind of part of your question. But I never really sampled the instrument or any of the percussion. You know, it was just so much easier and faster for me to record it live. Now, on the other hand, what I have been doing for the last 3 years is building my own sampled orchestra. So I've got, you know, all the strings and all the brass and all the woodwinds, everything that I can't play and record myself here. I have those instruments built and I'm playing those out of the computer. That's the orchestra that you hear in Tomb Raider is all of my custom sampled orchestra.
Yeah, and I remember you were teasing on Facebook little pictures of you working on those and editing samples and stuff like that over the past year.
Yeah, I think it's something like, I don't know, it's in the some six figure, some ridiculous 400,000 or 500,000 tiny little samples. But to me, it's all about the round robin and getting the realistic sound and being able to easily convey from the computer what I hear in my head. And that's the only way I could do it was with custom samples.
Yeah. But you're keeping those to yourself.
Oh, yeah. That's the other thing.
Yeah, no, and that's, I mean, obviously you've earned the right to do that. And I'm sure we'll all just be sitting here jealously regarding those those samples.
Well, you can be jealous of the samples. You would not be jealous of the time involved prepping them, because I am not, you know, Cine Samples, or there is no team. It's just me.
Yeah, well, see, that's what's kind of remarkable to me is that you've managed to create this, essentially this whole orchestral library on your own, because you know, any of the sampling that I've done, that's always been the most dull and horrible part, is taking that material and turning it into a sampled instrument again. You go from instrument to a different kind of instrument, but that in between process is just a nightmare.
Exactly, it is. But boy, is it ever a rush of adrenaline when you finish that contact, you know, dropping in the samples. And now I do get someone to do the scripting because I can't write that stuff, but you know, playing it back the first time, like all the string runs that I've sampled. So if you hear any, you know, do kind of string run things in Tomb Raider, those are all sampled phrases that I got at a couple of different tempos, probably 20 different shapes and things, and I got up and down, and I can literally just like play key, 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 and they just...
And you've got the whole run.
And it tempo locks, and it sounds... Oh, it sounds so good. Stuff like that makes it worth it.
Yeah, well... Well, I'm glad it's... So that's done now. Did you actually finish the whole orchestra at this point?
I'm about halfway through the woodwinds. That's all I have left.
Okay. Are you allowed to drop any hints about what you're working on now?
Now, all the games, there's 5 different games, but they're all ultra top secret, and it's
ultra top, 5 of them. Jeez, that's...
Well, I mean, it's various stages of development, you know. I mean, Tomb Raider was almost, it was 2.5 years, and it'd be really intense for a couple of weeks, and then they'd go away for a couple of weeks, and then they'd come back and a month's worth of work, and then they'd go away for 2 months. And that's how all of these games are. I kind of equate it to being in college, where you've got 5 or 6 classes that you take, and usually, you know, the exams show up at different times, but occasionally you've got four or five exams that all land on the same day.
Yeah.
That's, you know, usually I'm able to switch. I'll spend an entire day on one game, and all the exams landing at the same day would be Tomb Raider and Dead Space 3. They had the same internal milestones three different times, down to content complete for the end of the game. They were literally the same day everything was due. So I would go from Tomb Raider one day to Dead Space 3 the next day, back to Tomb Raider, and then back to Dead Space 3. And that was about, that was kind of, well, what's the word I'm looking for when you're bipolar? That's what I felt like.
Well, it sounds frantic, but on the other hand, at least it's nice to have some dynamics in the sorts of material that you're working on. Keeps everything fresh.
Exactly. That's what I was going to say. It keeps it fresh.
So we have a lot of composers as our listeners here, as you probably know. So what I want to part with is asking you, if you could think back to the best piece of advice that you've ever received as a composer, what was it?
Well, I'm going to default to John Williams, because to me, he's kind of the ultimate film modern composer. And I know that he still, in his 80s, composes every day. It doesn't matter if he has a job, not that he has a shortage of those, but his point was he composes every day, he never stops, and that's just part of his being. Now, I don't necessarily compose every day, but what I took to heart from that is it's basically like a muscle, and you have to exercise it in order to make it stronger. So especially early in my career, when I didn't have a job, I was composing not every day, but I was composing 5 days a week. I was writing music. I was learning. I was figuring out how Pro Tools works. And I guess just never stop. You can't sit back and...
You were involved in some way in your passion every day.
Exactly. And I had maybe 3 or 4 years where my job was radio spots and voiceovers and dropping in music I'd already written, because that's all they could afford to license. And it was not composing. And I was doing that full time. But then inevitably, in the evening or on the weekends, I was going back and writing for independent films or just writing stupid library music for myself. That just, I mean, literally be like, wow, I've never done a reggae track before. I wonder what that would sound like. And just to learn. And especially with the orchestra stuff. I mean, with all the Dover scores that are available, kind of reading the scores and trying to figure out how they do what they do. That's always invaluable to me.
Yeah, I think that's very good advice for all the composers out there, and for me, and for the rest of us who look up to your work and can take that advice to heart as we go forward.
I appreciate that, but it is really weird thinking about people caring what I say, because I'm the one that was asking John Williams something 10 years ago, just kind of all excited. So the fact that even an inkling of that can kind of be spun around is wonderful. Thank you.
Well, it should be a good sign. I mean, it means you've made some serious progress, because you are definitely on the other side of that coin right now.
Who was it, Groucho Marx, that said, I would never join a club that would have me as a member? He said something
that like
that.
Like him.
That's kind of how I feel. It's like, you know, oh, well, I did Tomb Raider. Well, if I can do the Tomb Raider soundtrack, I mean, anybody could, because, you know, you never, what you do never really seems that, all I see are the kinks and the flaws.
Well, sure. I mean, you're always your own worst critic. That's
exactly. Thank you. And feel free to edit any of that down.
No. Okay. Well, Jason, thank you so much for coming back to chat with us.
My pleasure. Thanks.
While we're eagerly awaiting the next opportunity to talk to you and to hear what you're up to, where can our listeners find and follow you?
Oh boy. Well, I am on Facebook, Jason Graves Music. I am also on Twitter, @JG Music. And I am on SoundCloud, I think under just Jason Graves.
Awesome. Geniuses, make sure you follow Jason and take some time to listen to his wonderful Tomb Raider score, which is available now, I believe, wherever soundtracks are sold.
That's correct.
So until next time, stay tuned.